you know it already, it's always worth learning it again. Because we heard it as kids, we heard it at a funeral. You know, they were looking for something to say, so they said, listen, this person didn't do any of the mitzvahs. And they routinely, you know, beat old ladies with sticks. But
not a true story.
Does it not say love your neighbor as yourself is the whole Torah, and they were nice to one of their neighbors once? Right? In other words, we get used to, like, reinterpreting things. But to actually look at the original story here is going to be very rewarding. And perhaps we can go back a little bit in the Gemara. The Gemara has, let's go through this Gemara together. And the reason we're talking about this is because this week's Parsha, Parsha's Kedoshim, tells us that we need to love our neighbor like ourselves. That's what it says in the Torah. Seems pretty simple. Everyone in the world would agree. Oh boy, yes, the golden rule, be nice. Yeah, oh yeah, sure. But what really are we talking about? What does it mean? Right, what does it mean? This is Woodstock? I mean, what? So, certainly not, right? Tanu Rabbanan, our sages taught. La'olam yehe adam anvesan kehilo. A person should always be a humble man like Hillel, rather than a kapdon like Shammai. So Shammai, who was incredibly great and incredibly influential and very important, was too much of a kapdon. What is kapdon? So, you know, one of the things, a person says, I'm makbid.
Strict.
And he makbid, right, I'm careful, I'm strict about Chalav Yisrael. I'm makbid not to talk in the middle of davening, right? Makbid, it means to be careful. A person shouldn't be so demanding like Shammai, but instead be humble and forgiving like Hillel. So we have an example. There was a story where these two people bet some serious money. Each one said, right, to see who could get Hillel angry. So they had a pool going, who could get Hillel upset? It's my turn. I'm going to really anger Hillel. Also, Hayom Erev Shabbos Hayi. It was Friday afternoon. Says Chaim Palaji and Amud Chaim. Friday afternoon is the time that people fight the most. Especially Orthodox people keep Shabbos. So you can understand that there's something both spiritual in the air, but just getting ready for Shabbos. The pressure and the time is coming, and it's Friday afternoon. So if Hillel, the best time to get him by these people who were trying to get someone angry was on Friday. So we need to be ever vigilant and aware that that's the case, and not ever lose our temper on a Friday, ever. But you should wake up in the morning expecting that today's going to be more pressure and it's going to be more likely. That's Urchaim Palaji's addition at the moment. So, also Hayom Erev Shabbos Hayyab, the Hillel Chafaf Es Rosh. Now Hillel was washing his hair or something. So he's in the bathroom scrubbing away. Halach Le'avar Al Pesach Beso. So the guy came by the door to his house. Maybe Amar al Pesach Beisus. So he came to the house of Hillel. Amar Mikan Hillel. Does anybody live here named Hillel? Hallel, how do you pronounce it? Hillel. Hello? Right, Mr. He pretending to know who he was. If you could just imagine, this would be the equivalent of showing up in front of, right, you know, the White House, right? In front of the governor's house. Right, who is this? Who, right? Did anybody live here? Even on a smaller level, most people wouldn't put up with it. Come up with a good, like, a well-known rabbi, like Rabbi Muskin or something, you know. Is there someone Elazar lives here? Come on, like, I know who he is. This Atef, so he wrapped his head. You know, they used to wear like a turban, so it took him a minute to get wrap the turban wind and the whole thing, right? The whole. The Yatza Lekrasa came out to meet him. Amalo Bini, my son, Mahata Mevakesh, what would you ask? What? How can I help you? I have a very, very important question to ask you. Ask away, my son, ask. Why do Babylonian people have odd-shaped heads? This is an emergency, Rabbi. It's almost Shabbos. I need to know why Babylonian people have odd-shaped heads. Amarle, he said, Bini, my son, she'ela gadola shalti. You've asked a very, very wise question. I've wondered about this myself. Because they don't have proficient midwives. The midwives don't know what they're doing. If you look at me, right? So if you look at me from this angle, my left ear is properly shaped.
Yeah.
My right ear is pointy. It's a little pointy. You see that? There weren't proficient midwives. Right. This is not something that I but that's the truth. No, I know it because my mother used to say, a pointed ear, you know? What's wrong with you? No, but, yeah, in other words, because it was clear, when the kid comes out, you can, Shifra, in the Torah, was called Shifra, according to Rashi.
No.
She was really a chevet because she would massage and work the baby's heads and bodies back into the right shape. You know, children are very malleable when they come out.
Right.
So if you don't have a good midwife, you look like some sort of a Nimrod. Now this is a she'ela gedola. This is a very important question. By the way, on a deep level, it's worth considering this one. If we know that Shifra in the Torah, the mother of Moses, Yocheved, was known as Shifra because she would shape babies, apparently that is an incredibly valuable thing.
Does that mean what Shifra means?
That's what Shifra means, beautiful. That she would be, she would make, she would beautify.
So plastic surgery is okay.
Well,
perhaps
because you're forming.
Could be. It's good. Could be it's a mitzvah. Make yourself look nice. But in any event, Hillel, right? Hillel is saying something that's a she'ela gedola. In other words, there is a tremendous depth to this, which you're not going to focus on so much tonight, but it's something to consider. Why was Shifra's focusing her attention and spiritual energy into making these children look good?
Mm-hmm.
And what's the significance of the idea that in Bavel they didn't have that sort of focus and attention
mm-hmm.
on the newborn babies? Right? So that's something that you could really just think about. And I have a theory of my own. My daughter Shifra, so I give them some thought.
Maybe because, like, you know, the whole mazal thing, like, whatever. We believe that mazal is something that you could work around and, you know, get above it, but they didn't. They're like,
very
what,
nice.
Whoever is born
that's
that way.
That's an intelligent theory. I mean, they don't believe in, right, that's really, really
improvement
something.
Or your law is your law.
It'd be
yeah.
nice. All we'd have to do in order to substantiate that is find some source that in Babel they were particularly focused on mazal or something.
Well, they're astrologers, weren't they?
Zoroastrian, you know, yeah, it seems so. It's beautiful. So then, a few minutes later, Hillel goes back, takes off his thing, gets back to washing his hair. You know, he's got the head and shoulders in there. He comes back, and the guy says, same thing, Nikon Hillel, where's this Hillel guy? It was Hillel I spoke to? Who was the guy I spoke to? Hillel, Hillel, right? You know, he's screaming at the door. So Hillel comes running out. My son, what is it? He's like, another very, very important question. Mipnema einehen shel Tarmudian trutos. Why do Tarmudi people, the Tarmudi group, have slanty eyes? Yeah, he wants to know about, like, oriental eyes. What's that all about? It's all weird and slanty. He says, you know, it's really a very intelligent question. He says, because they live among the sand. So Hashem built them in a way, right, that they'll be able to withstand the windstorms and the sand. You know, it doesn't get in their eyes as easily. He waited a little longer, another spell, and then came back to them, asked him one other off-the-wall question. Comes out and says, why do Patagonian people have wide feet? After all this, you know, Patagonians may have wider feet. So he says, what a smart question, my son. He says, because they live among marshland, sort of like snowshoes. You know, it's easier for them to walk.
Like Argentina, Patagonia? Or?
I don't know. It sounds like it's an African place. I don't know. It's not 100% clear. African.
Like a missionary biologist.
Isn't that funny? Right. In other words, you say, because we certainly those who didn't believe, right, in evolution at all,
mm-hmm.
still understood adaptation.
Right.
You know. But in any event, Hillel, the other approach is that Hashem developed, you know, the people deliberately that way.
Yeah.
And it's not even necessarily adaptation, but
same
thing. But there's no, Hashem could also create an evolutionary process too if he wanted to do that.
Right.
So you've got to ask him about how he decided to.
Right.
So the guy said, Amar lo, she'elos harbe yesh. The guy said, I have loads more important questions to ask you, right? But I'm worried that you'll get upset at me. So Hillel wrapped himself up and sat down with all the time in the world.
Wow.
Said, any questions you have for me, go ahead and ask.
Well, right Shabbat
before
right?
Shabbos? Or
right before Shabbos, he says, anything in the world.
Wow, isn't that nice?
He wouldn't lose his temper. And if it was time for him to go, when it was time, when it was the last minute, he would have said, you know what, I just have a few minutes. Just very calm, nothing ruffled him at all.
Hmm.
He didn't believe he deserved more honor. He was fine. He was totally fine. He was he was the most chilled out guy.
And he showed respect.
Unbelievable. He was just, my son, what an intelligent question about the Patagonians.
Maybe he was being sarcastic.
He was not sarcastic. He was kind. He was gentle. So the guy said, Atahu Hillel Shekarnos Honasi. So are you that Hillel that everyone talks about is the prince of the Jewish people, the leader of the Jewish people? He said, I am. He said, Amalei, Im Atahu, if that's you, Lo Yirbu Kamos Chabi Yisrael. I hope there'll never be any more like you in the Jewish people. I hate you, says the Hillel.
And he
so
was Jewish?
This guy is just trying to get him angry. He's going to make $1 million. And he has an unbelievable bet if he can upset him. Rabbi like, Benimit Neima, why? Why are you being so angry? Like, I'm being so friendly to you. What, right? Because of you, I lost in a bet 400 zoos. a massive sum of money, a few years' salary. So he said to him, you should be more careful with your spirit, with your, you know, more careful with your feelings. Like, don't be so rash in the future. Kedai hu Hillel. It's worth having a Hillel in the Jewish people. It's worth having Hillel. Sheta abed al yodo dal meosuz vidal meosuz. Having Hillel around is worth you losing 400 zuz and another 400 zuz. The Hillel will yakin, and Hillel will not get angry. He's not going to get angry, even if you spend another 400 zuz.
Is that what his friend said?
That's what Hillel said back to the fellow. Which almost, we just said Hillel was humble, right?
Yeah.
Imagine you're being really, really humble, and after you finish your whole humility, you say, now look at me, look how good I am. And I was so humble and kept my patience so long.
Yeah.
He was above it.
It's worth it. I'm better than you. How humble is that? So what's the punchline? You hear this? What's the punchline? How is that humility?
That's still humble to me. I mean, you got to have some, you know, self-respect, something.
So, you know, I'll tell you one interesting
thing.
He's
teaching a lesson. He's a teacher.
So that's also, these are possibilities. And I don't think that it's, you know, the question is, very often you have in the Gemara, this is like a general rule, if it tells you somebody stood for a certain midah, then you will find, like a certain character trait defines a person, you will find blatant examples of the person doing the opposite.
Wow.
So Yaakov is emes. He's truth.
Right.
There's nobody who's more of a swindler in all the Avos than Yaakov.
His brothers.
Right? With the sheep and the speckled ones. And this, there's no more with love and all the things. There's nobody else who's a positive character. Who Esther is known for her modesty. The Gemara says. There's nobody who's more known for a public intermarriage. Right? Hey, Rabbi. You understand? Hello, Rita.
Yeah.
You guys with me? In other words, basically every time somebody stands out, so it's never, the answer, you can sometimes weasel out of it. No, you don't understand, yeah, it wasn't being truthful, it's only this, it's only that. But the deeper answer is always going to be that the question itself is the answer. Like, right? That's redefining modesty, it's redefining truth for us, it's
right.
A deeper, anytime it says someone was the first person to do something, in the Gemara and Brachos, for example, there's a list of people, there's an obvious person who came before that person who did it.
Why does the Gemara do that?
So, for example, it'll say, I'll give an example and I'll show you why. It says, the first one ever to say thank you was Leah. So everyone says, like, to really say thank you. Famous Midrashim and Gemara is that saying, Adam HaRishon said, Tov Lahod El Hashem. He wrote Mizmor Shel Yom HaShabbos, and he said, Tov Lahod, it's good to thank God. So how do you say Leah was, the answer is, though many people, it says Avram was the first one to call Hashem my Adam, my master. What about this source? What about that source? What about the next source? The answer is, until that person came, though it was done many times, it was never truly done. So the definition of a real thank you only started with Leah. And you have to look at it. What did she do? She appreciated that she didn't deserve it. It was more than her portion. Because she only said that when she had Yehuda, which was more. She was going to definitely be getting more than all the other wives.
Right,
because she had her fourth kid. So they knew there would be 12 sons and 4 wives. So once you have your fourth, you say thank you. First three, you feel you earn it. You deserve it. It's mine.
Or she felt bad until then. She didn't.
So here we're going to show that Hillel's apparent arrogance is like crucial to what his humility is. As we go further. Another story. Tanu Rabbanan, listen to this one. Maisa Benachri Echad, there was a story with a Gentile, Shebolifnei Shammai, who came before Shammai, Amar Lo, and he said, Shammai, kama torot, yeish lachem. How many Torahs do you guys have? How many Torahs? He said, 2, says Shammai. The written and the oral. There's Torah Shebichtav. And Torah Shabbal Peh, we have a written Torah, and we have an oral Torah. So the guy said, about the written Torah, I believe you. But the oral Torah, I'm not convinced. So Shammai said, Ga'ar Bo, he got furious with him, Vahotzi Obin Nezifa, and he drove him out with anger. With Nezifa, with a snort, you know. Get out of here. You're coming and hassling me, right? I have things to do. Balifnei Hillel, came before Hillel, and he said, convert me, on condition that you teach me only the written Torah, but not the oral Torah. So Shammai chased him out.
He's the same guy.
Same guy. So he comes to Hillel and says, would you convert me on condition that you just teach me the written Torah? Hillel says, yes, and he converted him. Didn't take 2 years. Right? It didn't take a whole hassle around the block. Did you come to minion, this and that? Yes. You're Jewish, get the moil. Oh, Ethel, call the moil in. And the guy started to regret it, you know, quickly, you know. Mila, down in the mikvah. All right, mazel tov, have a negila.
Instant conversions from back then, huh?
Instant conversion. But there was a condition.
If you're a friend of Hillel.
That's right. Hillel used to do this. Rashi says, how did he do it? He says, you're not allowed, you're not supposed to, samach al chachmaso. Hillel relied upon his wisdom. Maybe his wisdom, maybe the convert's wisdom. We could see this guy's wise. Shasofo sheyargilenu lekabel olav. He knew that after a little bit of time, the guy would get used to accepting Hillel as his teacher.
He read him.
And if he accepts Hillel as his teacher, right, so then he's going to accept the oral Torah. He says, this guy didn't deny the oral Torah. He just didn't believe yet that Hashem wrote it, which is intelligent. The person says, I'm not convinced yet. So this is okay, but this is a guy who's convincible. So I know he'll see the truth. I'm confident that I can convince you that in my backyard I have a bicycle. I'm confident, because it's there, and you're an intelligent person. So it's not going to take anything. To convince somebody that there's an infinite God who gave the Torah, and that the oral Torah is true, requires nothing except an intelligent person, and a person who knows how to explain himself. So it needs the wisdom of Hillel. Mm-hmm. There's nothing. It's obvious there's an infinite God. There's no question about it. It's there. It's like a bicycle. So Yom HaKama, the first day he comes to Hillel, I'm like, Aleph, Beis, Gimel, Dalet, 1, 2, 3, 4, A, B, C, D. L'machar Apich, the next day he said, okay, the first letter of the alphabet is Tuf, and Tuf, the gematria of Tuf is 1. Shin, Shin is the second letter, the gematria of Shin is 2. The guy said, wait a minute, yesterday you said Aleph, Bet, Gimel, Dalet. Why are you going backwards? So he said, do you realize now that even to learn the written Torah, you have to rely on me? So why are you going to only rely on me for this part? You've got to rely on me for everything. So he said, you're right.
Is that quick?
In other words, the depth is, what does it mean, the oral Torah, the written Torah? How many Torahs do you have?
One.
Hillel is saying it's one.
Yeah.
Hillel is saying it's one.
Mm-hmm.
Even to really this one, the oral Torah, the written Torah are one unit. It's true, they're two aspects. But they're one. So if you're going to accept the written that comes along with the oral, there's no way you can have one without the other. And when he saw that, you're right. So that was it. Another story, another story of the Gentile came before Shammai. Amar like Gareni. He said, Shammai, convert me on condition that you teach me the entire Torah while I stand on one foot.
Mm-hmm.
This is the most famous one. Pushed him away with the builder's rule that he was holding. Amma, it's like a yardstick, but it's an amma long. And he said,
oh,
scram!
He, it was a
scram,
shot.
I say! Chased him right out of the edge.
Model for the Catholic nuns.
Balifne Hillel. He came before Hillel,
yeah.
Gearing. Hillel said, no problem. He had a moil on call. Amar lo, da'aloch sani. And then Hillel said, what you don't like done to you, after the conversion, what you don't like done to you, what's hateful to you, l'chavarech lo savet, do not do to your friend. Zuhi kol ha-Torah kula. This is the whole Torah, all of it. Le'idach pirushahu. Everything else in the Torah is but commentary on that. Zil gemor, now go study it.
So he didn't say, love your neighbor. Didn't...
Correct. He said it in Aramaic, and he said it in the reverse. He did not say, love your neighbor, but instead he said, don't hurt your neighbor in any way you would want to be hurt.
Yeah. It's a very special.
So that's a question. Why on earth did he do that? So I'll just tell you as an aside, I saw the amazing words of the Chidushe Harim, quoted, that's the first Rebbe of Ger, quoted in the Divrei Shaul, Rebbe Yosef, Rebbe Shaul Nathanson. So he says, what, why did he tell him the other way? So he understands, like the Maharsha, that actually there is an approach here that the conversion happened later. That he first taught him the Torah and only afterwards converted him. Even though that's not how Rashi or Tosfos learn it, and it's not the mainstream reading, and Rabbi Akiva Eger just blows away that Maharsha doesn't agree with it, that's the Maharsha's approach. So he says, why would he tell the Goy in other words? So he says, because the depth of being a Jew is only a Jew can understand love your neighbor as yourself.
So he, yeah.
A goy can understand how to behave like an ethical good person.
Mm-hmm.
But only a Jew can understand love your neighbor.
So he gave him the lowest aspect.
Therefore, he gave him, how do you love your neighbor? Treat your neighbor kindly. Don't
mm-hmm.
hurt him. Don't say anything you wouldn't want to hear, etc. He gave him instructions.
Mm-hmm.
The instructions are, here's what not to do if you love somebody.
Mm-hmm.
But to actually create that love, I'll explain it in a sentence or two, but it's very deep. People can move in together before they're married, so they can test out what it means to be married. But it never, it's no relationship to that, because being married is a commitment. You can't have half a commitment. A commitment means you're all in. So half of that is not half of that, it's nothing. To be part of the Jewish people is to be part of a unit with a singular purpose and a singular... It's like being part of that marriage.
Mm-hmm.
If you're part of that, you can say love as yourself. If people want to play house, they can pretend. A person can go lahavdil. It says a person who studies Torah lefrakim, only here and there. So it says it's like he's paying a prostitute. A person who studies Torah but doesn't do it consistently, so the Gemara compares it to prostitution. In other words, you can hire somebody, and you can say, and I'm going to say I love you, and I'm going to kiss you and hug you as if we're a married couple, and we're going to do all these behaviors, but it's nothing. So you can train somebody who's not Jewish to pretend to be Jewish. But the deepest level of Judaism, and if you and I don't feel this as Jews, so that's why there's no Beis HaMikdash, but the deepest level of Judaism is such an intense, family-like, almost marriage-like connection to every other Jew of every stripe and color, that we're so connected that no one else could ever understand that unless they were part of it. So you can tell them, listen, here's what it feels like, here's what it is, it's nothing. That's what's supposed to be. If you and I don't have that as a practical experience, so that's deeply unfortunate. It's deeply unfortunate, but as Hashem, we are getting better and better. So, okay. So that's what Hillel said. Third story, or fourth story now. There's another one. Guy came before Shammai. Oh, so here's what happened. This Gentile was walking behind a school, and he heard a teacher teaching the children about the beautiful clothing of the Kohen Gadol. So he said, but he didn't know whose clothing they're talking about, this beautiful clothing. So he said, whose clothing are they talking about? The Kohen Gadol, the high priest. The high priest in the temple wears these beautiful clothing. So he says, I want to wear those clothing. So he came to Shammai, and he said, convert me on condition that if I really work hard, I can become the Kohen Gadol. Now, to be the Kohen Gadol, you have to be born a Kohen. So he said, Shammai chased him out once again with the Amas HaBim, with the builder's rule that he was holding. Then he came before Hillel. Welcome, welcome, Mr. Bencher. He came before Hillel. And he said, convert me on condition that I can become the high priest, the Kohen Gadol. And Hillel said, no problem. Converted him. But then he said, listen, before you go and become the high priest, there's a lot you have to learn. Do you think that a king can become the king without learning the royal ways? So he said, you got to learn the Chumash. When he got to the verse, which says, Hazar HaKarev Yumas, a stranger who comes close to offer korbanos, right, to go where he should go, can receive the death penalty. You can't be the high priest if you're not a priest. So Amar Lein Mikra Zal Min Amar. Who's this about? Who are these people that are strangers that can't come in? Does it mean converts? Who does it mean? Amar Lein Afilu Al David Melech Yisrael. It means even King David, King of Israel, would not be allowed to be the high priest. Yeah, it's nothing to do with importance. It's an issue of roles, and it's not his role. This righteous convert thinks to himself, if Jewish people are the children of God and the firstborn of God, and still some of them can't come close, then it can't be because he doesn't love them, so he loves me too. So what if I can't become the high priest? Well, if they Shammai, came before Shammai. Yeah. Sorry. So then, Liyamin, this is like this. One day, the three of them wound up in a hotel or something. They wound up in the same place. So the guy said, the kapdonus of Shammai, the harshness of Shammai, nearly ruined my portion of the world to come. And the humility of Hillel is what brought me under the wings of the Shekhinah. Wow. Okay.
It's like two angles on authenticity. Looking for something.
That's right. So one thing that I always say, and I want to show this too, is that the Shammai experience was not a bad experience for the film. It was crucial. In other words, Shammai tells it like it is, which is very important. Every one of us has had experiences in our life where perhaps the system, friends, family, someone, treated us as a Shammai with less forgiveness and less, but those become very important parts of our life too. And they can be very, very important building blocks. It's not always the case that a person needs only Hillel treatment. He just also needs Hillel treatment. Okay. So now we go like this. Let's focus first on the middle one, but the middle story, about teaching the whole Torah on one foot. What does it mean to teach the entire Torah on one foot? What's that about? So the Maharshal already says that there must be one yesod, one foundation, one foot that the Torah stands on. I want to know the whole Torah standing on one foot. And so the answer is, this is one principle that teaches the whole Torah. That's the simplest approach. So the question is, what was Shammai saying? What was Hillel saying? So it comes along the Maggid of Mezrich with an amazing approach. The Sfas has a similar thing as well. Listen to this beautiful, beautiful approach. What do we know that has one leg?
Star.
Okay, they stand on one leg. There's another thing that's really famous.
A tree?
You're going to
a
kick
menorah.
Yourself.
A menorah.
Okay. There's something really famous that's talked about as being one-legged as opposed to two. Mama. And we, three times a day, we imitate that.
Angels.
Angels, it says in the prophecy, Raglayim Regal Yishonah, they've got just one straight leg. And when we dive into Shemona Esrei,
right?
We stand, we put our legs together
yeah.
to imitate an angel.
Right.
That's the halacha. The question is, obviously an angel is not physical, it's a conceptual thing.
Yeah.
So what could it mean that an angel has one foot, one leg? Explain the Svarim like this. There's a pasuk in Zechariah, which says, God tells the prophet, I have given you the ability to walk among these, bein ha'omdim ha'ela, between among these who stand still. The angels all stand still, but the human being walks. I think we once mentioned in the past the teaching that I tell the Lubavitcher Rebbe about the chessboard, as we call this.
Yeah.
The Lubavitcher Rebbe, you know, on the 25th of December. So the Lubavitcher Rebbe of blessed memory. We say that because he passed away. So, Zecher Tzadik Levrocha. So Lubavitcher Rebbe Zatzal was playing chess on the 25th with his father-in-law because they didn't on Christmas they didn't learn Torah, right? So
why?
They were why? It's a fascinating thing, but it's a custom that goes way back. It seems it may have started originally because if they caught you with lights on anywhere but the church, then you got killed. So they would shut everything down. People would hide in their houses. So that's one very compelling reason to shut down the issue.
In my note, they said they just didn't want to honor the day, and I actually asked them. I said, "Well, wouldn't it be why just honor the day, why just have a routine day?" And they said, "No, learning Torah is making the day special.
There are basically two sources in the actual literature. That's interesting that they said that. One of them is because the other approach. One of them is like the more historical approach, which goes together with the more spiritually descriptive approach, which says that all Torah learned on the 25th." Actually benefits the other forces in the world. Chitonim. And so you don't want to... Now, the Mir Yeshiva is packed 24 hours on the 25th, just like every other day.
But then you can't stand on a lot of days either.
That day is the birth of Yeshu, who came out of a Torah environment and so on. That's what they discuss. It's not the Lithuanian approach, but it was the Hasidish approach. And so they do other things. You know, they find other ways to...
All Hasidic?
Not all. But overwhelmingly, it's a pretty common thing. And Lubavitch is one of the famous ones because they have the picture of him playing chess, you know.
They play chess.
You know, they do something intelligent. And so he has a chess sicha. The Rebbe has like a part where he teaches Torah like through the medium of chess.
Mm-hmm.
So he says human beings are like the pawns, the weakest on the board. And the angels are like the rook, the castle, you know, the bishop, the horse. He says, but when you move to the end of the board as a pawn, you become a queen. And a queen is more powerful than all the other ones, well, except for the queen, but in this mashal, there is no queen, right? So, or if it is, it's more valuable anyway, because you earned it. So the idea is that the pawn is the human being, but it can progress and walk until it becomes... That's the human being. The human being is weak, but we walk and grow. And in that way, we're greater than an angel, even before we've walked and grown. Angels have one foot. They don't grow. You know what's also cool? If you don't walk, you never get thrown backwards either. You're always right where you are. So if you're feeling beautiful inspiration, then you're just there the rest of your life. So that's very tempting. Every one of us has had a part of our psyche at some point in our life that if only there'd be no trouble, right? If only I wouldn't have any challenge. If only it'd be easy for me. That's a big part of the human condition. This is not just like some Dvar Torah. This is like something every one of us has to come to terms with. And the answer is there's no such thing. Nothing good could possibly come from it. You cannot have courage if you don't have adversity. There's no such thing as courage if there's not adversity. In other words, from an evolutionary perspective, from a totally non-Torah perspective, it would make sense why we have insecurities, why we have challenges. Why, because all the things that are worthwhile to create require them. Isn't that something? So obviously we know Hashem had a reason for this, but I'm just saying, like, little reading that I've done from, why are people so insecure? Why are people, why is it so hard? The answer is, we are built that way in order to be great. Because all the things that are actually great, now the definition of greatness only comes from Torah and infinite truth. So really, it's a circle. These people think they're answering a question, but it's only answering it with Torah values. This is very valuable to understand. But the convert is coming. This guy is coming and saying, I'm willing to be an angel. I want to be a Jew. He comes to Shammai. He says, but I don't want this up and down. I'll give up on the big highs, says the Mizrachi Maggid, if I can also get rid of the big lows. I'll just coast. I'll be the same the rest of my life. So he chased him out with Amas HaBinyan, with a builder's ruler. So the Marsha said, no building could stand on just one little foundation in the middle. There's lots that goes into a healthy building. And there's lots that goes into a healthy person. Not just one thing. So he chased him out with a builder's ruler. In other words, look at this. So says the Mizrachi Maggid, the building of a human being, like the building of a building or a home, requires well-roundedness and requires challenge. If there's not that tension and challenge, human beings don't get built. So he chased him out with a ruler. Very deep. Comes Hillel. So what's Hillel going to say? Hillel says, fine, I'll teach you everything, how to stay on one leg like an angel. How could that be? So he says, what you don't like done to you, don't do to others, is the whole Torah. Love your neighbor as yourself is the answer. How is that the answer? Love your neighbor
can
as yourself is the
again?
Answer.
What did you just say?
Again, Hillel is answering a different question than teach me just the whole Torah. He's answering, can you teach me a methodology of going through life where I can be almost like an angel and not have downward swings?
Hmm.
So here's what Hillel said. You need to be part of the community. Love your neighbor as yourself. When you have a community, says the Mizrachi Maggid, and the Sfas-Emes, this is really the Sfas-Emes' answer, this part of it.
Mm-hmm.
He says, when you have a community, when you have a marriage, when you have friends, and I once heard someone say that his secret to his shalom bayis, he said, I think it was a Gentile who told me this on an airplane once, he said, the secret to his shalom bayis, he didn't use these words, the secret to his healthy marriage was that they never would lose their temper at the same time.
At the same time?
At the same time. He said, if one person's losing their temper, the other person would remain calm. Which was fun for them because it irritated the other person. He said, he remained calm. And if the other person was having a bad day, then that person would remain calm. If you can just stay calm, as long as the other person is being irrational and crazy, it's guaranteed. Human beings are sometimes irrational and nuts. But if you cannot have that coincide, then you're set. Because one person can say, listen, I love the guy, but he loses his mind sometimes. And the woman can say, the guy can say, listen, I love her, but she's off the wall sometimes. But when you're around someone else, someone told me recently in the shul, he said, he's lucky to have a wife. He said, because when he gets up in the morning on Shabbos, his wife is just like, come on, go to shul, I'll take care of the kids, it's fine, just go. And he says, no, he's not in the mood. Right? But he goes anyway. Yeah, because his wife is. And sometimes, and he feels so good about that. As an abstract concept, he feels so good about that. Nobody wants to be pestered. He says, no, come on, go, it's fine, I'll watch the kids. And he feels like, well, what am I going to do? When I tell her, no, I don't like getting up in the morning and dominating, I'd rather be an atheist, communist pig. Can't say that, so he's got it, right? Like, that's the feeling. In a community, another example of this, Reb Dessler gives an example in his own life. This is like a big Musser example. He said that, he used to say, we really care what people think about us. I think Rabbi Rochum is the one who said, says, like, when you could be sitting alone in a room where you don't know anybody, you're in an airport somewhere, you're somewhere alone where you don't recognize anyone, a random person comes by, strange looking, with foul breath, right, and a ridiculous hairdo, and you're like fixing your tie, Oh, someone's here, I gotta make sure. We really care what people, how people see us and what they think about us. It really does matter to us, and it's built in. So what he would do is when Reb Dessler wanted to quit smoking, because he was a pre-war guy, so they didn't know anything was bad with smoking. So he discovered it's really not good for you, he wanted to quit, so he told everybody he knew that he's quitting smoking.
Oh boy.
Now this is a great distinguished rabbi. Now everyone's gonna look at you, I thought you said you're quitting smoking. So he said that really kept him, that gave him a lot of extra strength and motivation because everyone's going to look at you. Putting yourself in a position where people will be dependent on you is a huge deal. So says the Sfasemis, that's community. That's why the Torah is something that's so fundamentally communal. And he says that's a solution. If you want to stop the wild downs without giving up on any of the ups, so you have to become friends and become part of a group of people. Otherwise, there's going to be tremendous ups and downs. Now, let's remember, Shammai is an individualist. Shammai doesn't really accept that you need to follow the majority. He says, follow the smartest person. And he's indeed smarter. But Hillel believes you should follow the majority, right? Even if Shammai is smarter than you. Because of the community, you understand? So Hillel's the one who says, listen, if you can connect in with others, if you can have a healthy marriage, if you can have healthy friendships, if you can have a healthy community, so that you can mitigate tremendously the downs. I truly believe that, you know, those of us who have children or want to have children, I mean, very valuable to know that generally the greatest way to achieve mental health in life is healthy friendships. It builds solid self-esteem. It's very crucial for us to make sure that our children have good friends and healthy friendships. It's an absolute must, and it's something that will be one of the most important religious things for them as well. If they feel good about themselves and solid about themselves and healthy and happy, so then the downs are much less severe. In fact, you find often that people that do have tremendous downs, what they do is they run away to a whole new group of friends. They'll say, for the first time in my life, I found people out on the street corners, right? Out in the, and they find this group of misfits. At least that's something. Sometimes it's too late. I remember as a kid, you know, the Columbine disaster. So we had no friends. People made fun of us. We had no friends. I mean, there was like five of them, four of them or something.
Yeah.
Why can't you be friends with each other, right? So it was too late. It wasn't a healthy friendship. It was too late. But that was, I think, like Chris Rock said that. Like, there's four of you. What do you mean you had no friends? I've got four friends in high school. So four friends now I don't have. So what do you mean four? There was two of them? Is there only two?
I think it was just two.
It could be he was talking about a different...
But they had a crew, though.
There was something. I think that was the joke. Anyway, I'm sure you can Google it. The joke worked. So
Crystal Mafia. It was a crew.
They had friends. What do you mean we had no friends? People picked on us.
I think the thing that unified them was the terrible thing.
Right. In other words, they didn't have a healthy identity that was developed through the mechanism of the incredible value. So this is what Hill's contribution is. Yeah, it's a disaster. I'm saying, and conversely, I really believe religiously and in many other ways, we can do a tremendous service to our children. For example, we buy our children clothing because they need clothing. Wanted to get their own clothing because they're kids. They don't know how. So we have to get our children friends also. It says in Pirkei Avos, "Knei lecha chaver," acquire for yourself a friend.
Mm-hmm.
When a kid is young, it may require you picking out who you think would be a good friend for them and making sure that once or twice a month you take them and that friend out to pizza. And they have these good childhood experiences with that friend and they grow up and go. It's a responsibility, just like to make sure they have clothing or they learn their math or that they have healthy friendships. And in my opinion, I would rather a kid, for my children, I'd rather them flunk out of everything in school, flunk everything, and have healthy friends, good friends, and feel good and happy and cheerful than the alternative of a really studious, happy kid. You know, no question. Now, we strive for both. We strive for both, but that's Hillel. Hillel is the incredible power of relationships. Let's see, how do we connect this in even more? I'll share with you something that connects. It's because it's so valuable, this idea. Last week's parsha, tying into this issue. Sometimes Achrimos and Kedoshim are even together. So in the beginning of last week's parsha, listen to what happens. Nadav and Avihu go storming into the Holy of Holies when they weren't invited, and they die. Fire comes out from heaven and kills them.
Right.
Why did they get killed? The pasuk says because they offered a strange fire when they weren't supposed to. Comes along the Gemara, and as usual throws like a curveball. And it says, why did they die? And it says, uvanim lahayu lahem, because they were too arrogant. They refused to get married and have children. They felt, who's good enough for us? Maybe there's different approaches, right? But they refused. The pasuk says, uvanim lahayu lahem. They didn't have any children. And it says, since they refused to get married, they refused. Not for me. Can you imagine? Not for me. Okay, so the question is why? Why did they refuse to get married? So the Mefarshim explained, there's a piece in the Agra Dakala, which is the din of the Rebbe, that says something along these lines, and there's a piece from the Tchelos Mordechai, of the Rosh Hashanah Shvadron, the first, the Marsham. Listen to this amazing idea. He says, there's two parts of life. There's the abstract, spiritual, broad concepts, and there's the down-to-earth implementation of those concepts. He says, you know, some people get too focused. Religion focuses sometimes too much on these, like, oh, we really believe this, but what are you actually doing? And other places only focus on what you're doing, and they don't give enough credit to the power of values, and this is an important balance, the two of them. So now an example of this is how you have in Tibet, right? You will have people, I mean, in India, Gil Locks told me this, Guru Gil, he was an Indian guru for some years, now he lives in the Old City, you know, one of these. So he was a real guru, Central Park guru, you can Google him, he's amazing. He wrote a book called Coming Back to Earth, one of the most interesting books I've ever read in my life. So you can eat Shabbos meals at him. He makes a Friday night meal, which is the most fascinating experience. It's just like going to another planet, watching an alien have a Friday night meal. Just totally different. He's amazing. So one thing that he said was, he said that there were places, I think he's the one who told me this, I think, that there's places in India where you could go, and you can pay in advance for 3-4 years, and they will lock you in like a dark room, inside of a dark room, inside of a dark room, and slip you meals twice a day or something, in a way that, and take care of, you know, your eliminations, whatever, in a way that you never have to see any light. You can just calm your mind and meditate. And people lock themselves in there for years. So they learn a certain amount of discipline, and they learn all kinds, right? They control their mind, they're breathing in one nostril, out the other, right? Like, they're doing all this stuff, and they're stuck. You're banging on the walls, no way out, there's no password. You have to really, right? That's what he said, that there are places where they do this. He himself was, like, spending a couple years meditating. He didn't talk for something like 5 years at all.
What?
He made up like his own sign language, and it was like there's a school of for the deaf or something that came down and like studied his invented sign language.
But the priests do that. They're going to do that.
So some people do this, right? In other words, they lock themselves away, take themselves out of having any impact on the world. And it's not that
American who did it.
It's not that they don't actually achieve some sort of control over their mind or something.
It's not practice.
They do
change the world.
It has no impact on you and me. It has no real impact on the world. That's no way to have a religion. Not even if you were young idealists. If you do that, so your soul will separate from your body. Very nice. So you will. You'll become a spiritual creature and no physical. That's okay. Like it was just the result of their behavior. Then bringing in this fire and having no... Where you go physically didn't matter to them. They'll bust in anywhere. It was all spiritual. It had nothing to do with it. Having children, with passing this along to another generation, with engaging with a wife and trying to make a life. They didn't value that. They didn't try to do that. So that's no way to have a Jewish people. And so they were taken out of the picture. That's what they said. Okay. There is a story with Rabbi Karlbach. What a story. You're going to like this story. The story goes like this. That Rabbi Karlbach was on an airplane. It was not an Israel. There was no Jews on the plane. The stewardess in the back, when he went to the bathroom to get a drink or something, was davening out of a sitter, which is unusual. There's not so many Orthodox stewardesses. He says, hey, you know, my holiest, sweetest... best person in the entire world that I've ever met in my life, right? How are you? You know, Rabbi Karlbach, you know, it's deepest of the deep. She says, you know, whatever. I converted to Judaism, but I'm having a hard time now. She said. So he said, well, anything I can do to help? She says, you know, I'm dating a fellow, and we want to get married, but his parents have said absolutely not. No chance in a million years. His father, there's just a father.
Oh, but
he says no.
Convert.
She's a convert. My son's not marrying a convert. So he said, that's crazy. What do you mean? Moses did it, right? He went through the whole thing. So he says, let me call him. He calls the father.
Moses? Oh.
So he calls the father. Right, calls Moses. Calls the father. The father is a Holocaust survivor. And he says, I don't know if she's sincere. Maybe she's just doing it to marry my son. She says, I'm the only one left from my whole extended family. And this is my only child. And how am I going to entrust? So I'm not saying he's right, but it's important to feel that person's headspace and his emotion. He says, no. I'm not going to support such a marriage. And the son was very sensitive to this, you know. If his father was a jerk, it's one thing, but this is, you know, a lot of trauma. So Rabbi Karlbach is always involved. Okay, one day he gets a call from this girl and says, Rabbi, you're not going to believe this. My mother, she's Dutch or something, you know. My mother was on her deathbed. And she called me and says, you need to bury me in a Jewish cemetery. So the girl says, why? I mean, I'm Jewish, but you're not Jewish. He says, no. She says, your father and I are Jewish. Here's the name of your grandfather. He was the chazan in this town. And here's the name of this and that. And we never, you know, after the war, we swore we were never going to tell anybody. right? Because what happens if this happens again? It happened before, we couldn't believe it. No, we're not going to let... He says, but now I'm dying, and I need to be buried among my people. So she calls up Rabbi Kalba, and before even calling the cemetery, right? First thing she did is say, I'm not a convert. I'm Jewish from birth. I can marry him. So Rabbi Kalba calls the father and says, I have the best news, my sweetest friend, you know. So he says, yeah, it's just a ploy. This is just a ploy. She's just saying this. She thought of an idea to marry my son. So Rabbi Kalba says, I'll tell you what. If her father would come down to meet you, would you meet him? And you'll see if you think he's Jewish, you know. He says, yes, I'll meet him. So this one guy who's been an Orthodox Jew his whole life through the war, and the other guy who has been a practicing Catholic his whole life since he was a little kid during the war, right? They come to meet each other. And Rabbi Kalba arranges this meeting, and come to the room, and one of them is, you know, the practicing Jew is holding like a glass or something, and the guy walks in, and he shatters on the floor. They just stand there staring at each other. He says, Moshe, Yanko, and they run over, they give each other a hug, 20 minutes, they're hugging, they're crying. They were childhood best friends. They grew up together, and they were best friends. And not only that, they both remembered vividly that one day they were sitting outside under the tree in the yard, and they said, we always have to be best friends. So one day, when I get married, I'll have a baby girl, you have a baby boy, and they're going to get married to each other, and then we'll always be together. That's the thing. And that indeed is what happened.
Wow.
Rabbi Kalba officiated at the wedding of these children. So what happened here? What happened in the story? What's so clear about the story? What's so clear is that the human connection... So really, I'm telling you this story because it's a good story, and it's an inspirational story. You know, whatever. Who cares what the shoe is about, right? The reason that it made me think of this is because the connection that we have with other human beings is more powerful than any ideology. I would never marry that guy. I would never talk to him, right? And people who hate Jews, who hate people just like you. Oh, no, but he's different. Right? If they have a personal connection with you, isn't that right? In other words, people that hate every Muslim, but they go, no, she's the nicest, no, Fatima, what are you kidding me? Her best bus, right? You know what I'm saying? Like, that's a very important thing to realize, that personal, actual, real relationships are stronger than anything else in the universe. I'll share with you something else. Hillel, what does he care about more? Does he care about himself, or does he care about others? Let's think this through. Meaning, Rabbi Akiva used to say, love your neighbor as yourself is a very important principle in Torah. Similar to Hillel. Zeh klal gadol b'Torah. That's what Rabbi Akiva used to say. We have a problem. Because Rabbi Akiva said something else. He said if two people are walking in the desert, and there's enough water for only one person. So Reuven has all this water. He thought to bring water. And Shimon's one of these guys. If his wife didn't pack it, he doesn't have it, right? So he goes on the plane. He didn't bring any water. Now they're out there stranded in the desert, and he's got nothing. And there's enough water to make it one day, and they're one day from civilization. So either they share the water and they both die, or not. So Bar Petula said that better for them to share the water and both die than for one person to live being responsible for his brother's death, for his friend's death. But Rabbi Akiva said no. When the Torah says to care about your friend, it says, V'chei achicha imach. Your friend should live alongside you. Chayecha kodmin l'chayecha vercha. Your life comes before your friend's life. Your first responsibility is to keep yourself alive.
Then if you don't do that, then you're committing, you're violating it.
It's suicide.
You're sinning then.
Right, you'd be committing suicide by letting you both die. And if you want to give him the water, right, halacha can't obligate you to give him the water because then immediately as soon as he gets it, he's obligated to give it to you, right? Now he's the one with the water, gives it to him, okay? Right, then that just doesn't make sense. Why should one live more than the other? We don't know, so whoever has it keeps it. Yeah.
How is that different than from... someone, Chas v'Shalom, being pointed with a gun saying, kill this person and you have to take your life.
So if somebody pointed a gun at your
you
head and said, shoot yourself or I'll shoot your friend, you wouldn't have to shoot yourself.
Doesn't there like...
The principle is if somebody puts a gun to your head and says, kill someone else, you don't do it. And you let them kill you.
Right.
So, but if somebody put a gun to your head and said, shoot yourself, or I'll shoot him.
Those are the three...
No, that's
you wouldn't
what I'm
do
saying,
it.
Like, with the water and the...
So you sit still. If somebody tells you to violate one of the three cardinal sins, you sit still and don't do it. Yeah, that's all you have to do. But you wouldn't do an action.
Mm-hmm.
Here, you have water to save yourself. This is more similar to going to the hospital, for a person to go to the hospital, donate both his kidneys to two people that need kidneys, and then die. Giving up that water is not helping anybody. So the Akiva says, your life comes first, whenever it's equal, you come first. You put on your oxygen mask, and then you help the women and children and other people that could need assistance.
It says kamocha.
Love your neighbor as yourself, but whenever it's me or him, I come first. So when is it kamocha? That's the question. Says the Maharsha, because of that question, Hillel told the convert, what you don't like done to you, don't do to others. It can't be literal that you have to do everything the same as yourself, because it's not the same as yourself. You are always a little bit ahead. Now, why does Hillel have that approach, that you're always a little bit ahead? Because Hillel believes that I, Hillel, am an asset of the Jewish people. Remember how he spoke and said it's worth having a Hillel around, no matter how much money that costs you? The really humble person actually is more selfish in some ways. Let me explain this idea. The halacha is, if you have just enough money for you to study or your child to study, you study. Just your family, should you support your family, send your kid to the yeshiva, or someone else's kid to yeshiva? You first have to send your kid to yeshiva. And only then can you help someone else. Why? Why? Who says? Right, where does this come from? So the answer is, listen, if I'm in charge of myself, then I could say, ah, for me it doesn't matter. But if I'm just a worker for someone else, the king gives me a machine and gives another guy a machine, says, I want you to both use your machine well. My first responsibility is to do what I was told to do. If I'm told to study Torah, if I'm told to do the mitzvahs, my first job is to do my job. The person who thinks he owns himself can say, I'm going to help someone else first. But the person who realizes my own life is not really my own, I'm a vehicle for something bigger in this world, and it's Hashem, and it's God, it's Torah, mitzvahs, so you don't even own yourself. Hillel doesn't see any ownership over himself. Hillel is responsible to make the most out of whatever he can for himself. So there's a story with Hillel that he said, I'm going to do kindness. His student said, where are you going after shir? There's always one guy following the rabbi around. Where are you going? Right? I'm going to do some kindness. I have a guest, you know. So where did he go? He went to the spa and he was sitting there and, like, you know, the base on haircuts, he got a foot massage, a haircut. So they said, what do you mean? You said, he said, yeah, gomel nafsho ishkes. If I would do kindness for someone else, give him an apple, that's a mitzvah. So I'm giving it to myself. It's also chesed. Meaning he wasn't living for himself. If by me having more rest and feeling better, I'm a better teacher and a better husband and a better friend. So it's totally selfless. Hillel was a guy who was so humble that himself was never the issue. So he could look objectively and say, whatever I do is really important. Because it wasn't him anymore. This comes to Rabbi Akiva and adds something to this. He says, Zaklal gadol b'Torah. When is it a major principle that you love your neighbor as yourself? When it comes to Torah. Explains the Chasam Sofer. When it comes to spirituality, there's no rule of you come before your friend. If there's only a little bit, one Gemara to use, you share it. If there's only a limited amount of time to learn, so then you have to spend time teaching people who know less than you, even if that limits you. So you have enough, one guy could go off and become the greatest and most learned person, and the other person remains ignorant, or he could spend an equal amount of time helping others. So he has to settle for more mediocrity in order to help others, as the Chasam Sofer says.
Even in relationships.
In everything. As long as it's spirituality. When it comes to physicality, there's a principle. You first take care of yourself. But when it comes to Torah, we're held to an even higher standard where everyone's equal and everyone's the same. And the Chasam Sofer elsewhere explains that you never, ever lose. God built the world with spirituality, that if you give up to help someone else, he reimburses you so you don't lose. Mm-hmm. So Avraham Avinu, who spent all his time helping others, was actually, he says, really should have been spiritually at a much lower level. And Hashem says, you don't lose.
Mm-hmm. There's actually, I think, a verse in Mishnah that says, Ish chesed has
Gomel
to be selfish.
Gomel nafsho, ish chesed.
Is this it?
That's Hillel quotes that passage. Gomel nafsho, ish chesed. It means a person who does good to himself is also a man of chesed, or a man of chesed is good to himself. So that's the principle.
I was going to ask, is this is related to the fact that the one thing you can covet of your neighbors is their Torah learning?
Right.
What does it mean?
Yeah.
It tells you that since the Torah learning is not mutually exclusive, right? In other words, if he has silver and you want his silver, so we've got a big problem. Only one of you can have it.
Right.
But if a person has spiritual wisdom, right, so you can have it too, and he can have it too, and it doesn't affect each other. So kinas sofer, our sages say tar b'chachma, jealousy among wise people just enhances wisdom. It's only good. That sort of jealousy is good because you don't need his. The danger of coveting is he has my wife. That wife should be mine. That car should be mine. That house should be mine.
Right.
And he shouldn't have it by definition.
Right,
it bothers me just as much that he has it as that I do. Which is true. If something really belongs to you, if you find that it bothers you that someone else has success, it's likely because you believe it's yours. So it makes sense. If you come into your house and someone else is sleeping in your bed, it should bother you just as much that you don't have a bed as the fact that he's in there. The heck are you doing in there? So that's why coveting, if it ever bothers a person that is, he has this house, this car, this thing, it's likely because we wish it was ours. If you see a person drive by in a nice car and say, boy, I'd like that car, well, would you want him not to have it? No, I can have another one. So that's already, that's kinna, and it's not one of the Ten Commandments, and it's another emotion. It's jealousy. So then you have to learn to be happy with what you have and not always look at other things and wish you had them. But it's not nearly as pernicious as chemda, which is, but when it comes to a Torah study, it can't be. There is nothing that someone else could have of spirituality that you can't have too, and it's not mutually exclusive. And if he teaches everything he knows to you, he doesn't lose one thing. Okay, so just to sort of conclude and tie this up, what Hillel lets us know, in a nutshell, is that the source for absolute passion and happiness and controlling the downs is relationship and community. So there's got to be a way. There's got to be a way that we connect more to our communities and develop healthier relationships. We need to study Torah. When you study Torah, you study with a chavrus. You don't sit by yourself all day and study, even though you can. You know, it's best to study along with other people, along with peers, to be in the yeshiva, to be in an environment where people are growing. When you pray by yourself, it's one thing. When you pray with a room full of people, it's different. Mm. It's different. You know, even people with terrible voices add when they sing in a choir. It helps. Right? In other words, you have somebody with... It's really something. There's somebody who I know who occasionally comes to shul and he sings way off key. Unbelievable. But if there's just a few other people singing, it adds a ton. Because he makes a lot of noise and it adds everything. And like, he doesn't need him to have a solo. Right? But that's very important to understand. I mean, that's true about all of us spiritually. That sometimes we may be off key or out of touch. But by being all together and in one place, so then we really have the opportunity. At Har Sinai, it says the Jewish people surpassed the angels. Because at Har Sinai, they were all unified. Mm. They were all one. And when we're all one, we surpass the angels because we have only the positive, which is that we can grow past the angels, and we lose the negative of the part that you could go down. Because when we're all together, we all kind of support each other, and we build an ecosystem where people shouldn't fall through the cracks, and everyone's cared for. That's what we wanted to share with you. Yes. Even.
And also... explains what the very first thing that she connects the very first thing that she said, which is that everyone in the Chumash has, like for example, the Yaakov is Emes.
Right, I could have explained that more right then. In other words, Hillel's incredible humility was such that he could almost talk about himself as if he was completely out of the situation. I'm just a servant to everyone else. I'm nothing of my own. So it's good that there's a Hillel around, right? Right.
So when you step outside yourself, your own ego, in fact, and like see things, including your own self, objectively, so that therefore he wasn't over assessing or diminishing the perspective on himself. He's being more truthful, right? More accurate in the way he perceived himself in relation to others, right?
Exactly. Yeah.
Wasn't there another passage in the Talmud or something that they were discussing the same concept? And Rabbi Akiva came and said this, and someone else came and said something, you know. It was weird.
Well, he once gave a share on that. That's interesting.
I think
it wasn't with Rabbi Akiva, but it was the same. It was Ben Anas and Ben Azai. And
they said weird things, though. This is the greatest. Remember
that one? Yeah, that's it. And then,
yeah.
Well,
that's not in the same...
That's not in that same Gemara. That's a midrash of dubious authorship. Meaning, we know it's a midrash because it's quoted earlier. It's quoted in other places.
What is it in English? Or is it not worth repeating?
No. It's a midrash that describes other opinions about what's the most important pasuk in the Torah.
Oh.
We once gave a class on this. I remember we once had a share on this. I remember when it was. It was the same night as Tanya and Brad's wedding. I think. Remember that? And then, like,
yeah.
We came back in the middle of it. Yeah, I went back at the end for like the second dance.
So
they were different. One of them was that consistency, right? One korban in the morning, one korban in the evening. Like consistency was the most important one. Trying to think, I have to look back. It's an introduction to the Ein Yaakov.
It's
really interesting. The different approaches, and they sound like sort of off the wall, but then they, Yeah, the people are busy.
It wasn't anything like you would think grand, like, you know, loving your neighbor. It was just something random.
Like,
you never think that would be the greatest thing.
Right.
And also, what was this page that you were reading?
Shabbat 31.
31.
That's where these Gemaras are about Hillel and Shammai. And Shammai keeps saying to all the people, lo! That's how you can remember this. He's waving a stick. Can you convert me? Lo! Lamed Aleph.
What were these?
It always helps. Samech Ayin. The Gemara in Shabbos says Samech Ayin. Simanin Asay. Yeah, if you make a simon for something, you don't forget it. Page 31 in Shabbos, a good page.
Is this A or B?
A.
Is this supposed to be a contrast in the two approaches? Is it supposed to be like judgment versus Hesed or Gevurah, you know, or something like that?
Yeah, we've actually given in the past a share on Shammai and Hillel, where Shammai is Gevurah.
Yeah.
He's Din, and Hillel is Hesed or Rachamim, depending.
Yeah.
It's good to see you guys.
In all the stories that I heard about Hillel and Shammai, they're always opposed, and it's like Hillel is this world, Shammai is next world.
Right.
Yeah, what does
that
mean?
Why isn't there more of like a yin and yang type of relationship where they created and shared it together?
So the Gemara says they did. The Gemara says the people from Hillel and Shammai always married each other.
And families made.
In other words, they were two separate yeshivas because they were truly two different ways of seeing the world.
Did they ever meet physically?
Yeah. They were at this inn together with a convert.